आ गया। Can you just open the screen a little bit? I think only some part of the screen can be seen. Alpesh, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Can you open the screen a little bit? I think only a part of the screen can be seen on Facebook.
No, you need to start sharing your screen. That should begin it.
Yes. Even now.
Now it will.
Is it? Yeah, perfect. All right, so gradually everyone is coming. Do we have our other speakers also here?
Yes.
Okay. Right. So maybe I'll take a chance. We have some people here. We have about 500 people here, but still I'll take a chance and tell you. Okay, Tazeen says the remedy step is agree, even before me telling the case. This is really interesting. This is Antaryami Homeopathy. Hello, Srishti Gowri has joined us. Thank you, Srishti. Many people gradually joining. Upcoming homeopath has joined us. Dr. Alpesh, who is this upcoming homeopath?
We need to check. Everyone is upcoming actually.
Yeah. Dr. Paranspe has joined us, but he is also the speaker for today. Dr. Bharat, hello. How are you, Dr. Bharat? And Madhumita, Vinod. Darius, how are you doing, Darius? How are things in Poland? Vishal,
there are few attendees in GoToWebinar app from Brazil, from Belgium, telling you hi.
Okay. Hello, how are you doing, guys? From Brazil,
Romania.
Belgium, Romania, yes, and some from Switzerland and France also, hopefully.
Yes.
My best wishes, but I can't see your comments. So, if you can help me with the comments, I'll come to know. A lot of I'm going to be coming to Brazil in hopefully, God willing, in November. So I'm really looking forward to coming to Brazil for one. There's one homeopathy congress there. and Belgium, some doctors from Belgium I met in my Switzerland seminar that time. So, yeah. So I want to take a chance and tell you that tomorrow is a very, very special day. It's one of its kind because I'm going to have a very, very interesting talk tomorrow with Dr. Sankaran. And interestingly, it's not going to be about homeopathy, but it's going to be about life, about how he actually became the homeopath that he was. What was the passion, the drive in him that made him become who he was? And actually the human behind, the person behind the success story that we hear about. This is going to be a very, very exciting time tomorrow. Tomorrow, 6 p.m. So tomorrow we don't have Materia Medica series. Tomorrow, just take a break for the entire day. Okay. Eat a lot in the morning, sleep in the afternoon, and come and watch us 6 p.m. live. It's going to be a 45-minute talk, and I think it'll be very, very interesting. Dr. Alpesh, are you excited for the session tomorrow?
Definitely.
Yeah, the only thing I want to tell you is that we are having very quick registrations. We have only 3,000 seats, and the registrations are finishing for this inspiring talk of mine and Dr. Sankaran. This is the first time we both are coming together, and this is a little bit like a little bit of a conversation about inspiring things in homeopathy and life in general. So if you have not registered yourself, I can't help you later on. You have to register yourself because because it's fast filling, and if the registrations go high, then later on we can't have you in. So whatever you're doing, you watch my lecture today and then quickly go to the link and register yourself. So yeah, this is going to be a very, very special session.
I think in the end of the session, we'll put the link in our bio so that people can register.
Yeah.
So we'll do that.
That'll be perfect. That'll be great. I think it has always been my very, very big dream that I wanted to interview, a no-hold-bar interview with Dr. Sankaran. Well, I'll be asking very, very interesting questions, not about homeopathy, but about life in general. So it'll be very interesting to know how he was as a person and how he became the person who he is right now. It will be very interesting. You can suggest me some pointers that I could ask, maybe. Maybe. And we are also in Materia Medica series day 11. So I hope you know at least 10 remedies really well. And God willing, I want to make sure that at least through the quarantine, we still have 2 weeks to go, and at least two more weeks I'm going to teach you Materia Medica. Like, I'm going to give my everything, and every day I'm going to come up with a new remedy, and we are working on a book on Materia Medica, actually, where the way I understand the remedies, the way we understand the remedies through understanding all types of techniques and methods together, keynotes, Kolkata method, classical method, sensation method, repertory method, Segal method, all methods bringing together and understanding remedies is what we are trying to do. And I hope that it becomes as popular as my other books. I hope you're reading my books on Sarcodes and Nozodes. It's a very interesting book. Sarcodes and Nozodes is a book I wrote in exactly 2 months. I wrote the book in 2 months. But the book that I want you to read is Decoding Mind Loop. It has a lot of my original ideas. This is a book, it took me 9 years to write that book. So Decoding Mental Rubrics, if you read from cover to cover, it'll be amazing for you. Yeah. Okay, so I think we are ready to start. Materia Medica series day 11. We are going to learn a very, very exciting remedy today. A remedy which is very, very interesting, and it's not so much used, but I think we can use this remedy so much more now. So So like every time, I'm going to tell you the case, and I'm going to tell you the theme behind the case. And then I want to know the remedy from all of you. Okay, so let's start with the case. See, we are going to talk today about a case of migraine and endometriosis in a 34-year-old lady based in Hyderabad. And the first time I saw this lady was about, I think about 3-4 years back. And she's this very plump lady who wears very, very flashy clothes. And she came to see me in my clinic. And the main thing she initially came for was her migraine. And she would describe that headache is too much. It's just too much of headache, too much of pains. I don't know what to do. The pains are so much, I really can't take the pain anymore. And this headache is more when she's stressed. Extreme headaches. And headache is also more in sun. Sunlight is one of the worst modalities for her as well. Any kind of slightest heat will cause her a lot of pains and stress. Stress is one of the main causes. And then she says very lightly, any kind of fights at home can really affect her a lot. Any kind of fight, and she is in a big, big, big mess. It affects her a lot. And then she also spoke about endometriosis, and that endometriosis is also affecting her a lot. And that she gets a lot of pains in the ovarian region before or during the menses. And this is dysmenorrheic pain. And the pain is so much that she has to take ultrasets and lot of painkillers. It's just unbelievably painful. I ask her, what is the effect of these problems on you? And she says it's very uncomfortable, especially when working. And it's very stressful. And she says, I work as a receptionist. And she works in a corporate office as a receptionist. And she says that it doesn't look good. You know, when there's a lot of pain, I have to touch in that area. And it's extremely painful. So we realize this is stress-related problems and hormonal problems. And especially in hormonal problems, I want to tell you, I try to understand the state of mind more than to focus at the modalities. You should know in which cases you want to focus at modalities, concomitants, and physical peculiarities, and in which cases you want to focus at the mind state. You have to learn this. This is the art. Art of knowing which area to focus where, when, in which cases. And I hope that through cases, I'm going to teach you about different techniques also. So about her, I ask her, can you tell me about yourself? And she says, I'm a very bindas person. Bindas is a little bit of a Bombay word, a word which is originated more in Mumbai. So for my friends from Europe and from the US, a little bit like, you know, a very chill attitude, a very cool attitude, someone who just listens to one's heart. Okay, so she says, I'm a very bindas, very open-hearted person, very open person, very shameless, very straightforward. Whatever is there, I'll just say it. I'm not scared of anything. I'm not scared of anyone. Jo bhi hoga, dekha jayega. I like to look good. I like people to look at me. I'm very stylish and very brand conscious. For me, looking good, wearing good clothes, wearing best brands is very important. And the other thing about me is I don't trust people easily. I said, why don't you trust people easily? She says, because people can be two-sided. They may show something inside, something outside. We don't know how they are actually. I can't trust people. I'm constantly thinking, you know, if a man is walking, I feel, is he looking at me? What is he looking at? Which area of my body is he looking at? Will he do something to me? This is a constant feeling. Will he do something to me? Will he touch me? Will he do something to me? Will he follow me? This is my constant feeling. There's a fear inside me. And then I ask her about her dreams. And she says that generally the dreams of mine are related to sex. Many, many sexual dreams. And often I see very weird porn graphics in my dreams. And animals having sex. And sometimes men and women having sex. Sometimes only men having sex. Gay sex. Lesbian sex. It's very sexual minded kind of dreams. And she was very cool while talking about it. This was very strange. She was very straightforward and not worrying too much about it, and very chilled out and very cool while talking about it. Oh, that's cool, no problem. This is the way she was. And then she told about her childhood. That as a child, you know, I want to tell you something. A lot of people here are writing natrum, your lachesis, platina. Don't try to find the remedy even before the case. Really first try to understand. I know most of them are students, but I want to tell you, and all of you, I really love a lot, all of you, every single person, and everything that I'm telling you is just with a lot of love. So I'm telling you that don't try to go to the remedy before really understanding the patient. And I used to do this mistakes before, and I have suffered, and many of my patients never did well when I impulsively gave remedies. So I'm telling you that it's better to listen, study, analyze the case in depth, and then suggest the remedy. So that's why I would say that hold on to your horses, my friends. Hold on to your horses. Pun intended. Okay, so a lot of dreams as a child as well. And what dreams would she get? Especially dreams of dead people. Especially dead children, dead infants. They are cut open. Dead bodies are open. Children are cut open. This is something she'll see again and again. Then she speaks about fears. And she says, I'm especially scared of being cheated in a relationship because I don't trust men. I don't trust their eyes. They want to look at women as objects. And she doesn't like the idea of objectifying women. And then she talks about her stress. Oh, Dr. Subhas Singh sir has joined us. Namaste sir, how are you? It's a pleasure to have you. Stress. She talks about her stress. And she says that her stress is especially about her husband. And that her husband, she feels constantly is having an affair with someone. And because her husband, she feels is having husband affair with someone, which actually is not a fact, but she feels like that. She feels a lot of comparison, and she feels that her husband keeps looking at other women, and that creates a lot of jealousy within her. And there's a lot of comparison. And whenever she sees that he's looking at other women, she tends to fight with him a lot. She's very, very quarrelsome, fightful during that time. She says she was an average child, not a very good-looking child. And she was very attention-seeking as a child. She felt she didn't get enough attention that she deserved, she feels. And when I ask her about interest and hobbies, she says especially she likes to wear very good clothes. And one of her biggest dreams is to have a powerful role in her company. And finally, her sexual drive is very, very high. So this is a little bit about her. I'm going to tell you the case again for people who joined recently. So I'm talking about a case of migraine and endometriosis, 34-year-old woman based in Hyderabad, and she gets a lot of headaches related to sun stress. She gets pain in the ovary before and during menses. It affects her appearance a lot. She feels that her problems affect her appearance. And she describes herself as a very bindas, straightforward person who's very interested in her looks. but she doesn't trust people easily, and that is her one of her issues, that she cannot trust people, and she's constantly suspicious of people a lot. Then she also talks about a lot of her dreams related to sex, dreams related to men and women having sex, dreams related to only men having sex, dreams of animals having sex, dreams of weird pornographic kind of porn related videos, dreams of dead people, dreams of dead bodies being cut apart, and children who are cut apart, fears of being cheated, and she doesn't trust people, like I told you, and she doesn't like animals a lot, and she compares a lot her appearance with others, so she fights a lot with her husband whenever she feels jealous, and she's very, very attention seeking as a child, and her sexual drive is very high, and she's very chilly, and she has a lot of craving for sweets. She has a lot of desire for chocolates. She loves meat a lot, and she always sleeps with a position on the abdomen. Okay, let's see who tells me the remedy today. So what's the remedy? A lot of doctors are writing lachesis. Milin tells me conam. Sachin Sali says lachesis. Okay, what else? Prajakta, lachesis. Okay, what else? Let's see. Elizabeth says Sankris. Dhruv Darji says Apis. Okay. Jayashree says sound. I don't know what this remedy is. Nuzat says it's an animal. Okay. Ranjan says Sankris. Okay. Sanket, animal. A lot of lachesis. Bufo. A lot of bufo as well. Platina, animal kingdom. Bharat says anacardium. Pujit says cyclamen. Asmita says hyoscyamus. Shreya says Sankris. Ayushi says lacanainum. Gopu says platina. Hyoscyamus. So hyoscyamus and lachesis and some more remedies. Okay, so now how to analyze this case? Huh? How do we analyze this case? What to give how much of importance? How do we do it? So like I told you, I always start from peculiarities, or what is the most prominent thing in the case. So one of the most prominent thing in the case is this pain. And she gets the pain in the ovarian region always before menses and during menses. This is number one. This is the number one peculiarity in the case. Okay. The next peculiarity in the case, if you see very closely, and that's very strange for her, is a lot of dreams. And dreams are related often to, and most of her dreams are very sexual in origin. You must have seen that. Very sexual dreams, typically. But then she also talks about dreams of animals. No? And what about animals? Even animals having sex. So, animals copulating. Very interesting rubric. Huh? And also, she sees dreams of men. Okay. And what about men? What does she see? She sees dreams of men. And what are they doing? What do you think? What is it? What is the peculiar? What is the exact experience of the dream? Think. So a lot of what? Indecent behavior of men and women in the dream. Yes. And dreams of dead bodies. See the peculiarities. See how I'm finding the peculiarity. Dreams of dead body, and then there is a rubric, especially dissecting, cutting apart. And you can now see one of the top remedies there is Sankris, given by Kent. And then you can see the another rubric, suspiciousness, which is also there. But very interesting rubric, she fights after jealousy. So quarrelsome jealousy after. Interestingly, there is hyoscyamus and Sankris there. So now when I analyze the case, and this is Sankris contortix. Agistradon. So interesting. Yes, we are going to now understand the remedy Sankris contortix. So interesting. This is going to be a very, very interesting half an hour. We are going to understand this remedy like never before. And now, once you understand this remedy, you'll never forget it for this lifetime. Francois. Say Sankris. Hello, Francois. How are you doing? All good wishes to you. let's try to understand centrist contortics from and what happened after centrist. Let's try to understand. So I gave centrist contortics in 1M potency, 1M, one dose every month, and her headaches, migraine remarkably improved. In fact, I have the video of this case, and her even her endometriosis situation improved. A lot of cases of uterine pathology. Even I have a very interesting case of uterine cancer that improved on Crotalus cascabella. Is improving. Not uterine cancer, sorry, ovarian cancer. So a lot of animal remedies, especially snake remedies, are underused. So we are going to learn about them a little bit today. So, yeah. So welcome to the Materia Medica of Centrist Contortics, Copperhead. Can we take dreams of childhood into consideration? It's a very important question. I think you should only take the rubrics. And before taking the rubrics, you have to understand the pattern. And her pattern is which I'm going to describe you now, is that of very high sexuality and very, 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 very distorted sexual images with the idea of suspiciousness, with the idea of jealousy. And this typically, this kind of very, very weird sexualities, even the idea of rapes, even the idea of homosexuality is in the dream, in the idea of dissected and cut infants. This kind of state, this is typical of centrist contortics. So I don't look at one rubric, I try to look at the entire pattern. That's what I want to tell you. So now let's try to understand centrist contortics. Is also called as azistradon. And it belongs to the subfamily Crotalinae and the family Viperinae. And the name is especially derived by adistro, which means hooked, and odon, which means tooth, and contortus, which means twisted. Twisted hooked tooth is what is azistradon. Very interesting, this remedy. Centrist contortics, their behavior is that they are very quiet and very lethargic, and they try to lie very motionless, not making any kind of movement, very slow. But when agitated, they can strike vigorously. Copperheads rely a lot on olfaction for mate searching and prey and predator detection, and their forked tongue collects a lot of chemical signals that are detected from chemoreceptors on the tongue and in vasomotor organ related to the mouth. So this is very important. You know, it's also important to understand which remedy are we understanding. Who is centrist actually, and what does it do? A little bit of knowing about toxicology helps us. Also, centrist, as you know, in toxicology, the venom, it's injected contrastatin, and this kind of contrastatin is helpful, is also treating a lot of cancerous tumor. This is according to researchers based in California. Now, why I'm telling you is you can even think of this a very important remedy in ovarian tumors, in female tumors, in lung cancer. So I'm trying to give you very, very different ideas. I want to open your horizons. I want to broaden your horizons, and I want you to be creative people. I want our group to go ahead, build and become masters. I'm going to go a little fast forward because we have a little less time today with two speakers. So let's try to straight away learn about the remedy centrist. Centrist, like other remedies, one of the most important thing is very often patients who require centrist get a lot of dreams and related to animals and sexuality. One of the commonest dreams is dreams of animals biting. In Kent, there is only one remedy, Bovista. But Bovista, it's a fungi remedy, very naive, and the other very important remedy, centrist. A lot of dreams of snakes. And especially being bitten by the snake. also pursued by the snake. Very often patients will tell you, I feel I'm running and behind me the snake is running. You will often see senkus. One of the commonest things which you will see is dreams of rape. Very often I have seen one of the main indications of senkus is rape. Women who come to see us and tell us about dreams of rape or kind of sexual abuse or threats of rape. One of my patients used to tell me, I get dreams where men will come and they will try to rape me. They don't come and rape me, but I feel as if they will. So this kind of constant dream that someone will come and rape me is a very important theme of senkus contortions. There's a very interesting rubric I wanted to tell you. There's a rubric, dreams walking, trying to avoid tramping on poisoned syringes. This means that a person is trying to walk and there are many, many injections and they are poisoned and you may get that infection. This is a little bit about the anxiety and fear of senkus. See the beauty of this dream. This is a dream which has come in Massimo's writing. Interesting. A lot of fear of pointed objects. Very sexual. It's one of the most sexually high remedy in homeopathy. Dreams of being betrayed. Even dreams of being buried alive. You can see this is a very beautiful image that Dr. Juhi has come up with. So again, this entire presentation is prepared by Dr. Juhi. I think you should really congratulate her for her work, and she's really helped us a lot. One of the things you'll also see about senkus are they are very seductive and very, very flirty form of women. And that's why many of the rubrics of senkus come along with hyoscyamus and lachesis. How to compare it with lachesis? I will come to that. But let's first understand what this is. Most of the remedies who belong to reptile family or snake family have a lot of feeling of being neglected. A neglected feeling is very strong for snakes as well, which we normally don't think of. We normally think magnesium or lac group, but think about snake remedies also. Dr. Srimali has joined us. Namaste, Dr. Srimali. It's a pleasure that you join us and we really admire you a lot. Very adulterous. Very often senkus patients will be having a lot of sexual relationship, maybe more than one. Okay, how to differentiate with lachesis? I'll tell you a few points. Okay. How to differentiate lachesis? Lachesis, first of all, lachesis is a very hot patient. Senkus is very, very chilly. So straight away you differentiate. The other thing is lachesis is very, very talkative, very loquacious, very open. But senkus, on the other hand, is very, very a little shy, a little secretive, doesn't talk much. So that's the first difference that you see, and the kind of visual images that is there in the delusion level at senkus lachesis doesn't. Someone written here, Sunny Leone or Bipasha Basu. I don't want to say that because I don't want to objectify women, because I really respect and admire them a lot. So I wouldn't want to say that. So let's delete that message, Dr. Gopi. Both of them are someone who I really admire also. So let's not go there. Very much concerned about their appearance and this. Charmer. So along with lachesis, most snake remedies are very charming and very, very, you can say, quite, in a way, center of attraction in that way. There's a lot of feeling of anxiety. So one of the important difference between lachesis and senkus is senkus is very, very anxious. There's a constant fear that they will die. This kind of anxiety, and that's why senkus is known as a mixture of arsenic and lachesis. So lachesis symptoms are there, jealousy, suspiciousness, tight clothing aggravate, but there is a state of mind like arsenic. Anxiety, they will die. Anxiety, they will be suffocated. Anxiety, something will happen. presentiment of death, predicts time of death. This is so Senkris is Lachesis plus arsenic. Boric also has written about it. And not just this, it has also asthma like arsenic. One of the very interesting rubric which I want to tell you is they start quarreling from jealousy. This is very interesting. While Lachesis will be loquacious after jealousy, Senkris is quarrelsome from jealousy. This is very interesting. And they constantly, one of the most important things they see, they are very sensitive to the idea of rapes. This is not very strong in Lachesis. So very often, they are very woman-centric. Senkris are. So they have very sensitive to the idea of rapes, of kind of objectifying women, of sexuality. They are very, very sensitive. A lot of feeling that they will die. There's a lot of anxiety about them. And also, there is a lot of guilt complex. There's a lot of guilt. Because they see a lot of sexuality, there's a lot of guilt. And also, there's a very high sexual desire. A lot of fear of death. In fact, Senkris patients, when they go to sleep, they are very scared. Will they get up alive or no? So also very important remedy for sleep apnea. Dreams of dead bodies. Dreams of dissected dead bodies. Very beautiful image. Again, thanks to Dr. Juhi. This presentation prepared by Dr. Juhi, also Shrushti and Neha has also helped us. Nisha, sorry. Why did I say? All right. Dreams of dead bodies, especially infants, also very peculiar. Again, a beautiful image. Indecent behavior of men and women. This is something I want to talk to you about. See, Lachesis also has many sexual dreams. But the difference between dreams of Senkris and Lachesis is, while in Lachesis there is sexual dreams, a generalized sexual dreams, seductive dreams. In Senkris, it's often a very, very weird form of, what do I say, a kind of sexual dreams where there is a lot of violence and hurt and very, very weird and bizarre sexual positions of men and women, or maybe three men and four women, or animals with women, of very, very violent sexual dreams is what Senkris. This is what I've seen in cases. Dreams of naked men also, Senkris. Animals copy. Can you imagine animals having sex? That is a key generalized genius of Senkris. So this is what Senkris is. Someone asked me, what is the genius of Senkris? Genius of Senkris, it is of perverted sexuality. A lot of hormonal problems. A lot of anxiety like arsenic. And a lot of snake features. They want to be appreciated by others, yes. And they don't see, you know, this is something that you have to understand. They are not the typical pulsatilla who like caressing. They want a very, very different kind of sex also. They want a very different kind of men also. They are very fascinated by bad men. They are very fascinated by the idea of blackness. They are very fascinated by the idea of mysticness. Also stalking. They are people who stalk people on social media. And they also like stalking. So this is something that you will always see. Stalking people. People who make different names. They have a lot of fear of homosexuality. It's a very important remedy for endometriosis. You should remember this remedy. A lot of problems in the right side of the ovaries. So another difference is Senkris is more right-sided compared to Lachesis. Kent has treated one case of right ovarian pains. Okay. And there was only one symptom. The pain was before and during the menses. And on that, he gave Senkris in CM potency, which cured. See the beauty. Huh? It has asthma just like arsenic. Arsenic like asthma. Difficulty in breathing. have to bend forward, difficulty in breathing, exertion after, while lying, when falling asleep, with waking, and also has cough like Kali ka, cough at 3-4 p.m. Loose cough. It's a very important remedy for PCO. A lot of pain during and before menses, and that's why it comes very close to lac caninum as well. Stitching pain, also very important thing, you see. Senkris is more right-sided than Lachesis. Lachesis is left-sided also. What else, other things I want to tell you? There are many important symptoms here of Senkris, which I confirm. There's a lot of fear of death, like arsenic. And there's a very interesting rubric. They are very suspicious. They are more suspicious than Lachesis, more intensified. I want to talk about this in depth, but there's a lot of difference between elapid and crotalini. Remedies belonging to elapid and remedies belong to crotalini. But I'm going to talk about this next week when I'm going to talk about other remedies of crotalini and elapid. For now, I just want you to understand the whole genius of Senkris contortics and the way to understand Senkris contortics. And for that, I also want you to see a very, very beautiful video that Dr. Yash has picked up for you. Let's see if I can find it for you. Where are you? Mr. Yash. Okay, let's see.
This is so exciting!
And just what happens after the Senkris snake bites. Let's have a look. So this is a little bit I wanted to talk to you about Senkris contortics. And I also want to show you the very, very commonly, what is the repertory sheet that will be formed in Senkris contortics? Because a lot of people are asking me to show the repertory sheet again. One of the question is how to differentiate Natramur. No, Natramur is a different remedy. Natramur is a totally different remedy. It belongs to the mineral kingdom. It has a totally different pattern compared to Senkris. I think Senkris should be compared to Lachesis. It should be compared to Crotalis. Bharat asks, it is shy, but in this case it's open. Senkris is shy compared to Lachesis. All snake remedies are very open remedies. Okay, but if you compare, Lachesis is the most open one, but Senkris is slightly more timid than Lachesis. Lachesis, I would say, is the torchbearer of openness. Apis. The main thing about Apis is open sexuality as well, so it's very close to Senkris. But the difference with Apis, and which is a very interesting remedy, the main theme of Apis is the pace. The pace of APIS is very fast, very fast-paced, very hurried. One of the rubrics is fruitlessly busy, industrious. That is typically of APIS. How to differentiate Naja? Naja basically is Indian Cobra. So there's a lot of feeling of responsibility and duty. You know, Naja is a little bit Aurum plus Lachesis is Naja, if I have to explain it. Hyoscyamus. Hyoscyamus is basically, they will always look like Lachesis for you. They are talkative. But, you know, there is a little bit of foolishness and a little bit of fright at the back. Out of the heat. So there's a little bit of foolish antics place kind of state. Every remedy is timid, every remedy is open in that way, but typical thing is different. Murex is very affectionate. You know what's written? Allen's keynote. Dekho Allen's keynote, padho aap log. First read Allen's keynote. Okay? Whenever you read you watch my video, first read Allen's keynote. Dekho kya likha hai. Allen's keynote, Murex, see what is written. Okay, let's see if I can find it for you. Maybe I can find it for you in Patak. Murex. You can see very affectionate woman. Murex almost look like phosphorus. Yeah. Also very high sexuality, but they are different. They are very, very affectionate, very soft, very warm. And one of the other symptoms is they always have diagonal pain. This is a symptom I've seen. Diagonal pain from ovary to opposite breast. Agnus castus. No, Agnus castus is different. The sexuality of Agnus castus is different. The sexuality of Agnus castus is where they have done so much of... The rubric for Agnus castus is jaded rakes. Okay, I give you this as a little bit of a homework for everyone. What is the meaning of this rubric? Okay, you have to find this out for me. Let's see. See this rubric. This is jaded rakes. What does this mean? And what is Agnus castus doing here? You have to find out this. Okay? Find this out. Interesting. Someone asked me this question. Manisha asked me Lilium tick. Lilium tick, Lilium tick belongs to Lily family, right? And the main thing about Lily also is attractiveness. But in Lilium tick, the main theme is of alternation of sexuality and religiousness. Yeah? Very important remedy for prolapse. A very interesting case of prolapse of uterus which improves on Lilium tick. Sepia. Dr. Sepia and Senkris is exactly opposite to each other. Interestingly, both are there in the rubrics of dreams of rape. But Sepia actually totally goes into a shell, typically. There will be many craving aversions to different CPM. Also the physical constitution. What else can I tell you? Any other question that I can answer about? Okay, so I also want to tell you that I'm going to just tell you this again. So a lot of people have joined me. We are coming with a very important talk show tomorrow. It's going to be a little bit like a conversation between a guru and a disciple, a master and his amateur student. So it's going to be one of its kind. We never had this kind of talk, and you will see a chemistry that you may not never have seen before. What happens between a guru and his shishya, and how the guru shows the path to the shishya. And it will be very, very interesting for you to hear very, very interesting thoughts about life and principles and experiences and the secret of success. Tomorrow at 6 p.m., wherever you are, whatever you're doing, stop doing whatever you're doing and just join us at 6 p.m. It's one of its kind of a thing that's going to happen. I don't know if you would ever get to see this again. So, do watch it. I think that's about it. I have to be on time. I've been told that I have to be on time because sometimes I take 5-10 minutes more. So, I'm going to take this chance. Dr. Alpesh, Dr. Pratik, whom are we inviting first? Dr. Paranjape or Dr. Rasal?
I think Paranjape sir will come first, if I'm not wrong.
Okay. Let's invite him then. Can you help him to get in?
Yeah, he's online now. Huh?
Dr. Paran,
hello,
can
Dr. Gaurang.
Hello, can you come on the video? Okay, we can see you now. All right, we can see you. How are you doing, Dr. Paran Sape?
Yeah, I'm absolutely fine.
Okay, you look very, very happy. No, no nervousness at all. That's very good. So, Dr. Paran Sape is Dr. Paran Sape is one of my really, really closest physician that I know of. He's based in Pune. And the thing that I really, really like about him is he's a professor in the college LMHF, a college in Pune in Maharashtra. And the amount of people whom he motivates, young students, interns in homeopathy, is remarkable. He's very down to earth, and he's always, always, always helping students. In fact, he never asks me any question. He always supports me for a lot of my books are initially published by him, and he's really, really helped me a lot. And he's a very fine clinician. He sees many, many cases, many acute cases, and that is why I wanted to invite Dr. Paran Sape to talk about acute cases, because he has sometimes 10 minutes, 12 minutes to treat fever cases. How does he treat them? What is his way? So I wanted him to come and share. And he's one of the closest friend I have in the homeopathic fraternity. I have a lot of people who I know, but he's one of the closest friend that I have. But before I'm going to ask him, I want you, I couldn't get enough emails yesterday, so I'm a little bit offended, because normally I get at least 100 emails every day about the remedies that you learn. Yesterday I hardly got 10 or 12. So this is my email ID, gaurang@gmail.com. We have about at least 1,000 people watching right now live. So I want you to write to us, write to me what you learned today about Senkris contortix and what is the main thing you learned. And also write to me what else you want me to talk about. It motivates me to work harder, because if you don't write, we might have to stop the Materia Medica series. All right, so let's come back to, this is what is called in reportorial language as threatening. Okay, threatening. there is tarantula, there is positive, yeah. There is tarantula, stramonium, hipparcel in that group. So, okay, let's come to Dr. Paran Sape. Dr. Paran Sape, before you start, and I'm going to give you next half an hour to talk about so many things, I want to tell you, where does this passion and inspiration about homeopathy come within you? Aapke andar ye kahan se aata hai? Where does it come from?
Actually, very frankly speaking, I learn from the people like you, Dr. Rasa sir, Dr. Khaire sir, who are always my teachers. And basically, one of the very important thing in my life is my patients and my results. Actually, they drive me for the homeopathy. And one more name I want to say here is one of the very senior practitioner. He's no more right now. He was one of the inspiration for me. He was Dr. Sarasappan. We had he was our family physician, and for almost 25 years, we did not take a single allopathic tablet, and we were on his treatment. So he's one of the very inspirational homeopath from Pimpri Chinchwad area. He's one of my inspiration.
All right, that's great. But tell me, how was it for you studying homeopathy as a college student? What did you do, and what was the kind of, how did you get the path? When did you realize that you wanted to be a homeopath?
Actually speaking, entry was not by choice. There was no choice, so I ended up in homeopathy, actually. But there was inspiration. I want to share one incident over here. Again, the name with Dr. Sarasappan sir. As my today's topic is fever, there was one incident almost 8 years back. I was admitted with a dengue in a hospital. And for almost eight days, I was admitted in a hospital. And there was no result at all. I was not getting well. I used to get a paracetamol injection. I used to drench into the sweats, and fever never used to go down. One day, I think the owner of the hospital, who is our family friend, he came to me and asked me, "Sir, what do you think? Shall you get admitted in ICU? Think over it. Tomorrow we'll decide." So that day, that was the shocking incident for me. And that day, I called Dr. Sarasappan sir. I still remember it was around 3 o'clock. He came to the hospital. He took my place in 2 minutes. And at 5 o'clock, I took first dose. By 7 o'clock, the reading was around 100 degree Fahrenheit. And by 9 o'clock, the reading was 98.4 degree Fahrenheit, and that was shocking. And next day, that same doctor, owner of the hospital, came to me and asked me, "Sir, what do you have decided?" So I told him I have decided to go home. This was the marvelous result.
What remedy did he?
I don't know. He did not disclose. This is the problem with the homeopaths. So I really don't know what medicine he gave.
Okay.
But one of the very inspirational results, and such results, actually there are many homeopaths who are practicing like this. Some are known, some are unknown, some are famous, some are not famous. But I really salute such homeopaths who are practicing, and such homeopaths is the inspiration for us.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think on this note, I like to give you the stage. Share your cases, go a little slower for a lot of participants. Don't talk very fast, go slowly and share your heart.
Okay,
so I'm going to call it a day from my side.
Okay, thank you very much. So, hello viewers, am I audible?
Yes, sir, we can hear you properly.
Yes, okay. Mm-hmm. So, let us go to my PPT. Now, today's my topic is fever. Approach with short homeopathic cases. My today's aim and objective for this is to give confidence to the common homeopathic students to treat the fevers. What is happening recently is that with advancement of technology and many softwares, recently there is a confusion in between the students that sometimes the number of medicines have increased and sometimes they don't know what to prescribe. So what is my aim today is to give them confidence that yes, with the common medicines also we can treat the fevers, or rather any case of the fever. So let us go ahead. I think I'm audible very much. Okay, so first let us understand fever clinically. One of the most very important thing about fever is that what happens with the students or even with the clinicians, as soon as they start taking the case, they start analyzing it, they start repertorizing it. This is very wrong. One should understand the fever clinically first. This is very important. All our pioneers, including Indian pioneers and abroad, were allopathic doctors first. They were good clinicians and then they turned to homeopathy, and then they could do the homeopathy successfully. So one should be a good clinician first, and then one can become successful in homeopathy. So let us go in details of this. Definitely, I'm not going in details of fever, causes, types, pathophysiology, no. But I'm going to share few things which are very necessary one should know as a clinician. So this is the first slide. Everyone knows that for a 1 degree increase in Fahrenheit, 1 degree Fahrenheit temperature, there is pulse rate increases by 10 beats, respiratory rate increases by 4, our BMR increases by 7, and oxygen consumption increases by 13%. Now this is very important. Whatever you are, allopath, you are homeopath, but this information is very important as a clinician. Next thing, I want to talk about the myths and facts. There are many misconceptions about the fever, especially with the patients and even with the doctors. So let us understand few myths and what is the fact about it. First thing is that fevers are bad. This is the myth. What is the fact? Fevers are not at all bad. It is the body's immune response to the intruder, and it is for the protection purpose of the body. So fevers are not bad. Fever damages the brain. No. This is again a myth. Many times common people will say like this, but no, except the cases of hyperthermia where the temperature is around 107 to 108 degree Fahrenheit, then only it may have certain effects on brain, but otherwise no. Next is the febrile seizures. Febrile seizures are serious. This is the myth. Yes, one should not let our patient to go to such state, especially pediatric cases. But Definitely, febrile seizures look scary, but this is very sure that it does not cause any permanent damage. So one should remember, especially clinicians, okay? Let us go ahead. Fevers, high fevers not responding to the antipyretics are serious. Now here are two parts, high fevers and the fevers which are not responding to antipyretic. Now high fevers are serious. This is the myth. Even a simple common you can say viral fever may mimic or sometime go to will show it as a high fever. Next thing is that fever which is not responding to the antipyretics is serious. No, it is also a myth. Sometime it may happen that in spite of giving good antipyretics, sometime it may happen that fever may not respond to the antipyretics. It's okay. It will respond. No problem. Next thing is that count is important. Many times it happens that patients call us and they tell us, doctor, I am suffering from fever. The next question asked by the doctor is, tell me the reading. It is 102 degree. Oh, anxiety both the side. Yes, definitely. Count is important, but what is very important is pattern. Pattern is more important. What is the fluctuation in the temperature? This is more important. Chill is followed by heat and heat is followed by sweat. Ask about this. This is more important than anything. Next is feeding. The feeding should be given according to the preference of the patient. This is very sure. Sponging. Sponging with a warm water. Though it can be a cologne water or salt water, it doesn't matter. But sponging with warm water is sometimes essential to reduce the temperature. This is for sure. Talking about clothing. Now, again, as a homeopath, we believe in thermals of the patient. So according to the thermals of the patient, one should decide about the clothing. Secondary bacterial infection. So chances of getting secondary bacterial infection in the case of viral fevers is very low. This is one of the very important myth. Even doctors also don't know. 90% time it doesn't happen, but except there are some viruses which are high viruses, this may happen. Okay, but otherwise it is not so important, not doesn't happen. What is very important is one should watch for during the cases of fever is look of the patient, activity of patient, urine out, physical and mental changes, hydration levels, pattern of the fever, vital signs, investigations and complications whenever are necessary. One should look for that. Next, investigation. Now talking about the investigation, actually this is the vast topic. I'm not going in details of it. I'm not going to talk about the investigations of typhoid and dengue. It will take time. But one statement I can make is that within first 3 days of fever, especially first 24 hours of fever, one should not go for investigation because sometimes they are non-conclusive. But if the patient has toxic look and otherwise the investigations are indicated, definitely one should go for that. Now this is the commonest investigation, CBC. Generally we do. And suppose you go for investigation of CBC and you find the patient has a high neutrophilic count, probably you are treating the patient of acute bacterial infection. Definitely some other things are also there. This is not the conclusive thing, but this is one of the hint. Even as a homeopath, one should know that what kind of fever you are treating. Because in our Mater Medica, it is clearly been mentioned that the medicines are useful for intermittent fevers, typhoid-like fevers, etc. So sphere of action is very important. So diagnosis is very important. So this is the clinical aspect I completed. And let us understand it homeopathically. In homeopathy, definitely, there is no option for proper and complete case taking. Complete case taking along with physical examination, observations, investigations whenever necessary, and homeopathic analysis evaluation. This is the key of success that one should know about. So let us go ahead. Now, next slide is about hints. See, I am having experience of around 12 years of my practice. Definitely, I am not an expert of this topic. But what I have found in while treating the patients, I am sharing that. I am a student of homeopathy, and there are many homeopathic doctors who know better than me. But I am sharing my knowledge. So what I have understood, I will share it homeopathically. So one thing is very important, what I have found is that be simple, nothing heroic is required. What do you mean by this? When patient is in front of you, be very simple. No big rubrics, big theories are required. Just be watchful. The patient's case will unwind you in front of you. Just observe it and give the medicine. You will get the success. Next, don't touch the repertory till you understand the case. This is very important. People have this habit. Even I used to have this habit. Immediately, right from sentence one, I used to see the repertory, but this is very wrong. Understand the case, understand what you are treating, then only go ahead. And be open to any of the approach. Now, what do you mean by approach? That there are many homeopaths who are, you can say, I am good in mentals, I am good in physicals and particulars. So, okay, you may be good, but whatever is required in a case is very important and one should go for this. So let us see few cases. I am going to share you total 5 cases, very short, and we'll go slightly fast because time is constrained. So this is the first case. I could still remember almost 1 to 2 years back, one child of around 2.5 years old was brought to me by his grandmother. The history was there was some carpenter work going on in this home. And suddenly, some shrieking noise, the drilling noise came, like, whee, and child startled. After that, the child almost cried for half an hour, and after the fever was started. Now, I took the case, but this was the point I found, which was very important. So, I think remedy, everyone knows, it is not. I am specifically giving you very simple cases with very simple medicines. Let us go ahead. This is the answer. This is the Fatak's repertory, page number 154, fever noise from. The medicine is Bryonia. Bryonia cleared the case. So, very simple. What we saw here? Prescribing on causation. Okay? Let us go ahead. I think you are getting me and I think you are with me. So let us go for this next case, prescribing on concomitants. Now, this was the lady of around 25 years old, actually. She came to me with the case of a fever, and she was having fever with shivering, with bitter taste in the mouth. Now, I took her complete case, but there was no specific symptom to prescribe. I was thinking on that case, and suddenly she told me, "Doctor, yesterday I knew I am going to have fever." I asked her, "How do you know?" "Sir, what happens is that I start with the sneezing." So I said, "Then what?" "Sir, when sneezing is there and sneezing is uncontrollable, I know the fever is going to come." Oh, this was something different and this was something strange for me. I asked her how many times it has happened. She told me, I think in last 1.5 year, 4 to 5 times it has happened. This is definite that as soon as I start with sneezing, fever is the next. So I took the rubric as nose, sneezing, general, fever before. China was the medicine coming up. Should I go for China immediately? See the first slide. Yes, the fever was there with the shivering and bitter taste, which also China covers. So I gave the China. And China cleared the case. So this was the case where we prescribed on concomitants. We saw in first case, we saw the prescription on causation. In next case, we saw the prescription on concomitants. Let us go ahead. Prescribing on mentals. Okay. Now this is very important case, very interesting case. This is a case of one of the Sardarji uncle. He is a well-known patient, and he is my regular patient actually. What happened is that he used to come for acutes only, and I almost treated his 5 to 6 episodes before of acute cold and cough and fever. What happened with the last episode was I gave him the medicine, but somehow I could not find the results, and he was shifted to allopathy, and it took almost 8 to 10 days to recover. The condition was so grave that he was about to get admitted, but somehow with the medication he managed himself. So this time he came to me and asked me, sir, I have started with the throat pain and that throat itching, and I said, then what else? Sir, I am having fever also. I checked it just now, it is almost 99.5 degree Fahrenheit. I asked him, tell me more about. Sir, do you remember that last episode? Yes, I could remember. I told him, sir, that last episode, it increased like anything. And you remember, na, sir, I have to change to allopathy, and I was about to admitted, and somehow I have saved. Then I said, okay, then. He said, sir, please save me. This episode should not go to that level. Please do something. Please give me something. This was something interesting for me. So I took 2 rubrics here, alert mentally and fear extravagance of. Now, why 2 rubrics? Alert. Why alert? Because with the last episode, with the last experience he had, he became alert. This time, fear extravagance. I have already treated 5 to 6 episodes of him with good homeopathic results. Only the last episode increased. It is not necessary that this episode should also go to that level, but he has that fear which was extra and unnecessary. So the rubric was taken. The only medicine which was going through entry, which you can see on the screen, is opium. So opium, 33 doses actually cleared the case. Now, this is the case which shows that prescription is given on the mentals. Let us go ahead. Case 4, prescribing on drug picture. Sometime you don't have to use repertory. Oh, this was the case. This was very interesting case, and I could still remember this lady. What was the story? That this lady, around 65 years old, known case of pot spine, and she was taking treatment from experts for her pot spine condition, and since I think many months. Recently, since 3 to 4 weeks, she was suffering from a cough, which was aggravated at night, which was aggravated by lying down, which was better by sitting up, cough with the expectoration, and the fever. The interesting story was, since 3 to 4 weeks, she was taking allopathic treatment for which she was not responding. Her allopathic doctor confirmed that she is not having tuberculosis. This is for sure. So I took her case and I just told her, madam, I think we should go for admission because your condition is grave, and I think you should you require some expert opinion and some further investigations. As soon as I uttered the word admission, she started crying. Sir, please don't tell me about the admission. Sir, those people will give me lots of injections and salines and etc. Sir, I don't want that. Please treat me, sir. Sir, you take whatever time, whatever medicine you tell me, I will take it like that. Please don't let me go for that admission. This was surprising for me. A lady of 65 years was crying like a child. Then she insisted me to take the case, so I completed her case. I took the consent, because when you are treating such cases, medical legal aspects are very important. So I took the consent from the relatives and her, and I took her case. What was another interesting point in her was, when I was asking her the questions, I was writing down those points. And while telling the symptom or narrating the symptom, she used to moan during fever. She was there and she was moaning like this. And what was additional point is that 4 assistants were there with her to support her. She was getting support from her son, from her daughter-in-law. Constantly she was touching them, somebody was pampering her, etc. This was going on in my OPD in front of me. This was something strange. And additional point I could see is that whenever I used to write, I was writing something, the morning used to go down. And as soon as I started watching her, the morning used to increase. This was something strange. Somehow I got the gut feeling that whatever the intensity of the complaint she is showing, I think it is not like that. Somehow I cannot say it is a fingering illness, but the intensity is different than what is showing. So it was like attention seeking behavior. So I think medicine is clear with the drug picture, na? I did not use the repertory. I gave the pulsatilla. Pulsatilla is the medicine for this. I gave pulsatilla 200, 3 doses. I called her after 4 days. She came after 7 days and the entry was very classical. She came like a soldier inside and she literally gave me salute saying, "Doctor, you are a magician." This was surprising. She was better with her fever. She was better with her cough. So I gave ASL again. But one more interesting point about this case was, I was treating her and slowly, slowly she started getting relief for her pot spine also. She continued her treatment and since 4 to 5 months I am observing her, she is better with her joint pains, she is better with her generals, her appetite, even pot spine. So what is this? Is this medicine an acute medicine? Is a constitutional medicine? Or this acute was an intense chronic state? Yes, possibly. So this was the case where I prescribed on drug picture where repertory was not at all required. If you know the drugs very well, you can prescribe. Let us go to the last case. This is the case of fever. And again, an interesting case. Fever not responding to allopathic medicines. Now, this was the male patient of around 30 years old, came to me. And the history was, since 8 days, he was on allopathic treatment. Twice, thrice, he changed antibiotics, but there was no result. His investigations were already done. His CXR was normal. His USG abdomen was normal. His main complaint was cold, cough, fever, which was high grade. Very different symptom in him was there was some bad smell in his nose. He told me that, "Sir, when I'm in my room, I tell my relatives that please check, there is something bad in the room." The relative says always that there is some problem with your smell sensation. There is nothing bad in the room. So there is something bad smell in my nose constantly. So a male patient with cold, cough, bad smell in the nose, with high grade fever. With investigations, even the hemogram was done, leukocytosis was done, there, Vidal negative, dengue negative. Now, what to do? The temperature that time when I checked was 102 degree Fahrenheit. When I started taking his case, what was the very striking point about him was, he was constantly restless. He was sitting in a chair, he was narrating 2 symptoms, again changing the position, again narrating the 2 symptoms, again changing the position. I asked him, "What are you doing?" He told me, "Sir, this is the problem. I don't know why this is happening, but I just cannot rest." Students, please don't jump to arsenicum album immediately. Next, concomitant which was present with the case was sleeplessness along with the complaints. There was tremendous body ache, offensive smell in the nose, a toxic look, chilly patient, activity was absolutely dull, he was absolutely thirstless. I did his paranasal sinuses x-ray, paranasal sinuses waters view, which confirmed that it's a case of pansinusitis with infected both maxillaries. Possibly this was the reason that he was not getting better. The temperature was 102 degrees Fahrenheit and pulse was 150 per minute. This reason why he came to homeopathy is that initially he used to take paracetamol tablet, antipyretic tablet, whenever required. Then he started taking it 8 hourly, then 6 hourly, and now the fever was not responding and his allopathic physician asked him to take it 4 hourly. He asked me, sir, if I start taking this tablet every 4 hourly, what will happen to my body? So nothing was working, so I came to homeopathy. Now this was the story. Now I'm specifically telling you the summary of the case. This is not a complete case, but this is the summary of the case. So as everyone can do, I prescribe arsenic malbum, did not give relief. So what is the medicine? Very interesting medicine. Possibly few students may get it. I think I should go for answer. Pyrogenum was prescribed. Pyrogenum 200, 3 doses. It took almost 3 days to recover to this patient. The recovery actually went to almost 7 days, but pyrogenum relieved him like anything. Now, why pyrogenum? See, I will go to the previous slide. See the pulse over here. Pulse. Pulse is 150 per minute. The temperature is 102 degree. What it indicates? Yes. Pulse is disproportionately high. This is one of the indications for pyrogenum. What was happening with him? Perspiration was not relieving the fever. This is again the very important indication for pyrogenum. Now, I will tell you my understanding of pyrogenum as a nozode in such cases. Let us read it. When vitality has struck. Now, what do you mean by vitality? It is that vital force of the patient has stuck into the septic state. Now this septic state does not mean septicemia. It is the septic state and the infection has crossed certain limit and is not responding either to well-selected homeopathic medicine or other conventional treatments, and hyperpyrexia is the state. This is pyrogenum for me. So this was matching to the case. In this case, we saw a prescription of pyrogen as a nozode given as a simulibum. So this was very interesting case, and this is in very encouraging that if patients are getting such results. So many more to share, but I think time is very less. So let us go to last slide. What is the take home message? I think you have understood whatever I want to convey to you. Let us see what is the take-home message. Be watchful and never fear a fever. Initially, as a practitioner, even I used to fear a fever. But if you command the homeopathy, never this will happen, that you will never fear a fever. Whatever may be the fever, take the challenge. Diagnosis and investigations are must. This is very sure. Even though you are a good homeopath, diagnosis is must. Investigations, whenever necessary, very important. After treatment, patient should be better generally, particularly, and with investigations reports also, especially with the cases of meningitis. Yes, if with your homeopathic medicine, the patient is feeling generally better, don't get excited immediately. The investigation should also get better. If it is getting better, especially C-reactive proteins and everything, definitely you are on right track. Don't entertain the myths and educate the patient. So education of the patient, and before that the education of the doctor is very important. So this is very important line. The last line, don't hesitate for second opinion and references. When you don't know, please say no. This is very important. You are not a god. You cannot treat everything. Definitely one should be confident enough, but one should not do the things when he does not know, and when you don't know, please say no and refer the patient. So this is all from my side. I think I can convey something, some message to you. This will give you the confidence to practice. This is my WhatsApp number and this is my email ID. You can share my your thoughts on my email ID. Even for any of the queries, you can write to me on my email ID. Thank you. Thank you very much. This is all from my side.
Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful session. And now I think we would request Prasad Rasal, sir, to join us.
Yes, I am there. Are you getting my voice?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, we can hear you properly.
Okay. Shall I start or Dr. Gaurang will be there?
No, sir, you can start. You can start. Dr. Gaurang will join in the end.
Okay, okay. So, dear Dr. Gaurang, like what Dr. Shishir Paranspe and all number of homeopaths who are watching this seminar, webinar in fact, and who are there on the Facebook Live or who are there on as a member over there in homeopathic herb. First of all, many thanks to Dr. Gaurang for giving me a big opportunity over here, because I'm practicing since 29 years in Sangamnir and I'm handling lot of pathological cases. I'm working on avian vascular necrosis of femoral head, I'm working on Duchenne muscular dystrophy, I'm working on cancers a lot, I'm working on sterility cases. But at taluka level, I'm happy with my patient, number of patients or with the results. But still, I was known to certain homeopaths. I'm also a teacher since last 29 years and I'm teaching organum. Mm. And only thing is that with this, I was not approachable to a number of homeopaths, and Dr. Gaurang has given me this chance.
And I really want to say one very important thing before you start, that yes. I don't know whether you remember how we actually met. Do you remember how we met?
Yes, Dr. Gaurang, in Beacon Foundations.
So it's very strange. It's very strange. I'll just tell you the story for the participants. So what happened was, I think about 3 or 4 years back, I was this guy with a very hot blood, always very passionate. So I went for this case presentation competition where all doctors from all different homeopathic fraternity had come, and I went and I showed a case or whatever, and I won some prize also. I don't remember whether it was second or first, or I don't remember exactly. So probably second, maybe. So after this, I didn't know who the judge was. So I don't know, I just finished that case presentation, and a person gave me the prize and people started clapping, and then we were just going. And then actually my mind went toward the judge, because maine judge ko theek se dekha hi nahi tha till that time. So I just met him, and that is, the judge was Dr. Rasal. So that was the first time I met him, and he was very humble, and he gave me a few of his small booklets to read. And he also was very quietly, he was very supportive and encouraged me that, you know, the case was good and things like that. So this is the way I first time was introduced to Dr. Rasa. And from then onwards, actually, Dr. Paranspe has been very, very vocal about how big a supporter he is of you. And then I think a couple of times we spoke over the phone, and I also gave you a couple of my books, and probably that's how we got really involved. So I really admire your cases, your approaches. And more I speak about homeopathy, a lot of people, a lot of students, a lot of practitioners who know me, they messaged me yesterday that thank you for calling Dr. Rasal, because he was our first teacher. So a lot of people who I know are probably people who have learned from you. So that's how I thought I did the right thing, and I really wanted you to come and showcase your cases to a lot of people here. We will be having more than about 8,500 people towards the end of the day. People from US, people from Europe, India, everywhere. So I wanted you to specifically talk about avascular necrosis, and maybe some other day I'll invite you again to talk about muscular dystrophy, on which I'm also doing some work. So it'll be interesting. All right, sir, I'm going to give you the stage and I'm not going to talk in between. It'll be great. And towards the end of the talk, I'll ask some questions to you. Okay?
Yeah, for sure. We'll discuss the things. Thank you for giving me the opportunity. So I will go directly with the seminar, the webinar, and a warm welcome to all the homeopaths, all the homeopathic students. Everyone is a student of homeopathy. And today, Dr. Gaurang has asked me that I have heard a lot about your avian cases, and I want to listen about your avian approach. And that's why I will going to share three cases, but out of which only one case I will describe in detail. Other two cases, I will give the glimpses of it, but I want to share something which is absolutely my own approach. And that's why a very warm welcome to all of you on the behalf of Divine School of Homeopathy, that is our school. So topic is avascular necrosis of femoral head, the non-surgical homeopathic treatment for avascular necrosis. So we'll go with the first thing, that is the Audace Appear. Why I have written this Audace Appear? Because I will going to share something which is generally not accepted by the classical homeopaths. But I am the follower of the Hahnemann. Right from the first day when I started my practice, or I have started experiencing homeopathy, and I am doing a lot of experiments. I thanks a lot to Dr. Nitin Bagli sir, who has given me an opportunity, who was having orthopedic hospital, and I was a resident over there when I was in fourth year of BHMS and in the internship period. So 2 years I was worked with Dr. Nitin Bagli sir, his hospital, and he has given me opportunity to use homeopathic medicines on every patient who is admitted. Even his Bagli madam, she was an ophthalmologist, she has given a chance to me that you use your in my indoor patient, and I got a chance to treat retinal hemorrhage also with the help of homeopathy. So I have experimented, and this is what is the experiment which I have done in my life that I am sharing. So there might be something that I will going to discuss about the role of biochemic system of medicine and biocombinations, and that is my special understanding regarding how to treat those cases. So we'll directly start with the cases. First we'll understand case. And then, this is first case I am going to share, it is in detail. Approach is one and same. Everyone, what the way chronic cases we deal, it is one and same. Only thing that how I approach this with the help of a biochemic medicines and biochemistry, biocombination, that I will going to share with you. So that is a different approach. Otherwise, you will read the case over there. My colleague, the homeopathic doctor, he was 42 years. It was case taken in 2012. And he came to me, he called me first that, Prasad, I'm suffering from severe pain in my hip and right hip, and since 2 months, and I'm having tremendous pain. I'm fed up of it, and I fear that I might have a cancer. So I took the x-rays were normal, and then I have taken the MRI, and MRI shows that there is a avascular necrosis, and I'm literally disturbed. So everything was there, that the way he has, and he took, even he is practicing, at that time he was practicing more allopathy and occasionally homeopathy. That's why he took arsenic album, puja, rustox, as per suggested by senior homeopaths from the Pune. Then he called me, and he was in a disturbed state. As pain was increasing, affecting his daily work, not able to sweat or sit down or limping due to severe pain. He has done MRI of both hips, which showing altered marrow signals in right femoral head and the neck, is most likely suggestive of transient bone marrow edema and early changes of vascular necrosis of femoral head. Moderate right hip joint effusion, that is very important. That this is joint marrow edema is the most important thing which happens generally in cases of AVM. And this was there, and he was literally suffered. He was tipped absolutely in right. So tip complaint was right hip joint pain, heaviness as well as throbbing, aggravated by cold drop, aggravated by sweating, aggravated at the start of motion, and ameliorated by continuing motion. Right hand dorsally had a flat warts in 6 months, and this was the important thing. Fastishly there was bilateral renal calculi, the left heel corn operated in childhood. Family history, you can find it out. There was a history of diabetes, benign enlargement of prostate, the paralysis, the hypertension, the herpes zoster to the mother. So a typical history which is important for us to understand the miasm, it is there. This is very important, the state of disposition and mind. And generally, I take a whole case. I give nearly about 1.5 hours to 2 hours to deal with the AVM cases. I took everything. And thereafter, I played a very vital role in the part of homeopathic management that I will going to share later. So he has given, being a homeopath, he has explained his mental state very nicely. There was a history of disappointment in love before marriage in 1993-94, which made a lot of impact on him. He got married with a doctor in 1996, has 2 daughters. He has explained everything regarding the past history, past life history to the wife. As a result of depression of disappointment in love, he joined a religious community and got much attached with it thereafter till today. Because of his attachment with the religious community, he was spending much more time in the temple. And this created some disputes between him and his wife. She was expecting his responsibility regarding the daughters as well as his attention at home, which she was missing. There used to be some fights or quarrels between them. Whenever there used to be a dispute, he used to escape from home to temple. He told that he is much lazy and not proper in following timing. He was indifferent towards everything because of disappointment, because of disputes. He was conscientious regarding little things. During the interview, they asked me a number of questions, and he used to frown a lot like this while talking. So this was the case. Before MRI was done, he had a fear of cancer. He was worrying about the future when diagnosis was done. And there was a question in his mind, when these pains would stop. I'm fed up from these pains. While talking, he told number of his thoughts, theories regarding his life, regarding his religious life, everything. He was seen by an orthopedician who advised him to take anti-inflammatory with complete rest till the pain settles, avoid him sitting down or squatting or running and all those things. And this was the physical examination. Out of which, this is the most important thing was taught by Dr. Nitin Bagli, sir, that you must examine and you must able to understand clinical examination. So I used to do clinical examination with each and every patient. So on clinical examination, he was not able to lift the right leg easily as it was much painful. It was too stiff. Not able to bend his right leg and thigh on the abdomen. Not able to squat in lying down position. That there was tremendous tenderness in right hip anteriorly. These were the clinical findings. Miasmatic background, depending on past history, family history. It is typical psychosyphilitic miasm. So this is the data, and I have repertorized as I used to do. And this is the repertorization thing which I have done. And after repertorization, this was the result. First remedy found to be a sepia, which covers whole aspect, followed by a sulfur, lyco, succinic, pulsatile. So definitely, everything is covered under sepia, considering the miasmatic view, his approach, his depression, face greasy, the frowning tendency, everything. And my eyes covered over there. A typical brownish pigmentation was there on his face. So I have decided to go for sepia, definitely. But the prescription was that this is what is called as a homeopathic manner. I said, there is no restriction to the movements. You must continue with your all movements. Only thing is that you don't jump, you don't dance, or don't run. These are the only three restrictions. Otherwise, do all your activities. If you want to sit down in a squatting position. You can climb the stairs, come down, and everything you can do. So, exceptionally, regarding these three things, otherwise he can do anything. I have given three doses of sepia 1M2 along with biocombination number 26 for 15 days. Why biocombination 26 we'll discuss at the end, so that will be a different approach for all of you, because everyone knows that biocombination is 26 is easy for curation and why you have given to a chance. This question was asked by a number of practitioners, even number of students, even my from where I purchased the medicines, I used to purchase it in bulks, and they asked me whether you have a lot of delivery cases in your hospital. But it's something different I want to share with you. Follow on after a month, it was 15 days, pain in right hip 80% better. Occasionally aggravated at the start of motion, better by continued motion. Limping while walking still persists, able to squat on lying down position, able to bend the hip, tenderness in right hip absent, walk on right hand decreased in size. See, this is too important that within first 15 days, if he gets such a result, he believes you a lot. First important thing is at the level of Taluka, Sangam Nair, I'm practicing, patient expects that within 15 days they feel they get the result, that remains with you. If they don't get result, they will run out. My approach is always clinical. My approach is always to this point. Patients never understand the difference between cure and palliation. They understand whether they feel better after taking your treatment or not. So, second follow-up after month. And see the result, I have continued only with 26 number, nothing more than that. When in right hip absent, able to squat in sitting as well as lying down posture, limp absent, he danced in religious commune without any trouble, able to bend his hip. 1 hour played a dholki, that is not tabla, dholki in squatting position. Very much happy as he was able to perform all these duties and enjoy the. In fact, that was his hobby, that whenever they asked to go over there in commune and they used to dance and they used to do a dholki, he was not able to do it since last 2-3 months when pain started. And he immediately came out of it. It was an interesting thing. Even might be he is attending to the seminar because he is fan of me and he started doing homeopathic practice. He left the allopathic practice and completely shifted towards the homeopathic practice because of this. And thereafter, he recovered completely. Till today, he doesn't have pain. He is doing all the activities. He went to one Tirtha Yatra where he walked nearly about miles together without any problem thereafter. So this was first case, and we'll go ahead because we have less time. This is second case. I will give you only a glimpse. It was the 7th October 2008, it was a case which was taken by one of my colleagues on early in the morning, 7 a.m. In fact, he called me that, Prasad, I want to share my case because I'm not getting the result. This is very important that if you don't have a result, you can share it with your colleagues. This is, in fact, very important part on behalf of homeopathy. And he asked me, I have given physostigma to this patient since last 6 months in different potencies, but he's not getting result. And someone told your name to the patient and he's asking to show you. So better, I will come along with the patient and you take the case and you approach. So patient came with crutches supported by two persons. He took literally 10 minutes to enter the clinic from his car parked outside the clinic. That much stiffness was there. The crutches were there and two people supported, and then he came inside my clinic. He suffered a lot due to pains in both hips while walking and even while lying in bed. He was not able to sleep on back and he was not able to extend his leg. There was so stiffness that leg was completely stiffened over there. So I will not going to share. This is 1.5 hours video. I don't want to share. I took whole history and across. At the end of complete history, the colleague who was sitting nearby me, he said, it is an animal. I said, whatever it may be. Whatever gets prejudiced, whether it is animal, whether it is mineral, whether it is plant, I generally used to do one thing. I repertorize the things, everything. I asked him, let us repertorize and let us see what happens. Yes, you might be correct, but let us see what happens. And this was the repertorization which was done on the same day. And yes, only remedy which covers whole 26 rubrics was lachesis. Yes, animal remedy. So what happened? He asked me, myosin is definitely same psychosyphilitic. What he told me that, Prasad, I will handle the case near after. I got the remedy. So better to give lachesis 30 and placebo. I said, okay, it is your patient, so you can handle your case, no problem. Actually, I was damned to prescribe him biocombination 26 as well as Ruta, which I used to give as a continued in such types of patient where cartilage damage is there and when typical marrow edema happens to be there and patient is not able to move the leg at that time, because this is the remedy. These remedies clear the patient very fast. That is my first thing. So he said, no, we'll give with the classical way. Okay. So we gave the patient lachesis 30 and kept him on placebo. First two fellows taken by him, and he informed me that movements comparatively increased, but pains also increased. And patient called me to give follow-up to me. So I asked him to first take the permission of your physician, and then if he says, I will take the follow-up. And then he sent the patient to me. And I, on the 17th November, this was the day, problem, pain in hips, aggravated by standing, aggravated by walking, aggravated by rest, pain in hips, better in sleeping position, mentally more stable, no migraine attack, but stiffness was still there, he was with crutches and he entered in my. So, I have asked the regular exercises, I used to tell the patients of Avian. So I have advised him to lift every leg, then put it on up your tummy one by one, then both at a time, make a squatting position in lying down position, crease the both the knees, then turn on right side, lift one leg completely, then turn on opposite side, then again lift the leg. Ask him to lie down on abdomen and lift one by one leg completely. Also do a Bhujangasana. That also, these are the exercises I used to suggest the patient, and I have not even given lachesis next dose. I have given Ruta 10M twice a day and biocombination 26. And Ruta 10M, I have already told you that it is because it has very specific action at the level of a cartilages, epiphysis, and it works beautifully in such cases. And it is most inner structure where it patient you desire results. And that's why I generally use either 1M or 10M. I have given 10M. He came to me after 15 days. Limp in the left knee, the left hip due to more walking. Pain in the left hip much reduced. Movement in joints much increased. And 2 days back, there was a migraine attack. Sleep disturbing pattern. So here, because of a recurrence of a migraine attack, I have given lachesis 200 and I have continued with the rest of the two remedies. I have all the videos of that patient recorded. Every patient of Avian, I have the videos. It's a collection of 301 patients of Avian with me. And nearly about more than 280 patients, I have the videos. So Again, after a month, he came to me. So pain in left hip due to more walking, it was continued because he started walking a lot. Pain and stiffness in the joint much reduced, movement in the joint much increased. 3 times attacks of migraine in last week due to change in food habits. And now he has shifted from crutches and he came to me with sticks. Then, again, after a month he came, I have continued with it. One thing happened, he traveled Delhi, Mumbai for business purpose without any trouble. He was walking without sticks. That was very important after 2 months. And he was absolutely, he drove the car. One of the day he went to Goa. He took driver. He was from Serampur. He took driver. He left that driver at Pune. No one was knowing because of the family pressure, he took the driver and he left the driver at Pune, went to Goa for 2-3 days, drove a lot, again came to his place. And this was a little bit frivolous every time. So I continued with the same remedy and he came out of total disorder. So all the movements were absolutely normal. He was walking 3-4 kilometers without the stick, without any problem. In between, I have used the lachesis in different potencies with by combination 26. And later on, he was in fact doing each and every activity. See the difference which happened after giving a biochemical combination and before giving a biocombination. That was very important. And this is the third case which I will going to share with you. It is again, I will not going to highlight each and everything because it is done in the similar manner. In fact, this is the patient from Mumbai. I have, this is the first AVM case. It is in year of 2002, 7th November 2002. This patient was even advised total hip replacement. He was in fact serviceman and he was not able to climb that dagger, and that's why he was in a condition that he should leave the job. But every family members, all of them are dependent on him, and that's why he can't leave the job. And he was in a very frustrated state, and he was very much fearful regarding the surgery. There was history of allergic bronchitis and lipoderma in the past for which he has taken consumed the steroids so much. So I will not going to give all those details, but I will tell you that how I approached. This was the life space investigation, which has given each and everything. He has given very good history, and that's why I was able to come to a very clear cut remedy. So I repertorized the case, taking into all the details of the patient. So I don't want to discuss with that. These were clinical examination was important. Left leg shorter than right because of the AVN. Stiffness in left hip, can't bend it, can't lift the leg, and walks with limping. And this was very important that you have to do. Now this patient, 18 years have been passed. He used to visit me every 6 months or a year. And he shows me, he's doing all activities. He comes, lies down over clinical table. He used to do all activities, including sitting, everything. He says that I'm walking 5-6 kilometers a day. 18 years is a big period, which shows you that remedy has cured him. This was MRI before coming to me, which suggests that there is a left hip AVM causing architectural distortion and subarticular irregularity with left femoral head with mild joint effusion, and left acetabular margin is normal. Right hip normal. So these were the rubrics which I have considered for this case, and I have started with the repertorization. Calcarea fluor was the remedy. So through and through calcarea fluor was there. I started him directly with the calcarea fluor, and I asked him all the typical homeopathic management, all the things which I used to tell the patient. These were the follow-ups. So within follow-up, with follow-ups, with intercurrent cipollinum as a destructive disorder, as a miasmatic remedy, I have given 1 or 2 doses. Otherwise, I have kept him long time for the calcarea fluor. And you will find that I have kept every patient's record. if every avian case, before starting the treatment, the MRI, and after 2 years, 3 years, gaps MRI. This was the second MRI, which was done on 21st December in the same Jupiter scan in Mumbai, and which showed here that there is a, as compared to the last previous MRI, the reduction of marrow edema in the neck that was seen in previous MRI. The hip effusion which was seen in previous MRI has also resolved. This is too important for us. This evidence will show to the world, yes, homeopathy works, and it removes the disorder, right, even at the at this level. So again, after 2 years, I have continued him with calcarea fluor, and again in the month, in the year of 2006, I have done one more MRI. And you can hear what he has written, that read it, very important. This, there is no edema as compared to a previous MRI. There is no significant interval changes of the, no further progression of the disease is seen, right hip and both sides and sarcoma. This is too important to understand. And now we'll go ahead with the main topic. I will discuss a little bit time, Dr. Gauram, just this is very important. Avascular necrosis, yes, it is the vessel that is posterior superior retinacular arteries, which are major supply of the head of the feet. And one of the branch might get obstructed, can lead to ischemia and proliferation necrosis over there. It most common reason is always the long-term use of steroids, and which is most common reason nowadays, because number of patients suffers either with rheumatoid arthritis, asthma, or dengue, or viral fevers, and a lot of steroids are given, and patient ultimately turns towards the avian. This is commonest reason, and there are other reasons. Then avascular necrosis. See, this is the how this might, this is the traumatic avascular necrosis which can happen over there, that has been mentioned over there. I will highlight this. This is something which I want to discuss. Since I have started practice homeopathy, I have read the Schussler's book on 12 tissue medicine. And I have worked out with each and every remedy, all 12 remedies. So I suggest everyone to go to only first 2 pages of that every remedy. And those, if you understand by heart, you can use biochemic and biochemic biocombinations in your practice absolutely with a very good results. If you go with the remedies, the Ferrum Foss, this is the study of pathogenesis of the remedy, which I have highlighted. But I will suggest that you understand remedy with that physiological chemical data or general pathological action, general biochemical action, which is mentioned in Schussler. So you will understand the how to use that remedy instead of going into the symptoms of the remedy. Ferrum Foss, which is the most important remedy for first stage of inflammation, that is the congestive stage of inflammation. Kalimur is for the second stage of inflammation, where you will get the edema, the effusion over there, which develops at that time. Kali sulfuricum, third stage, where suppuration, early stage of suppuration, and followed by calcarea sulf, which is next stage of a suppuration, which happens to be there. And last is fourth stage, where fibrosis develops, is the solution. Then calcarea fluor is the fifth stage of degeneration, where you get lot of degenerations forming osteophytes, having the effects on the vessels, forming dilatation of vessels, ischemia due to the deposition, loss of elasticity. MacFoss, it covers the spasms, pains, and neuralgias. Everyone knows. Calcarea foss is very important. Out of these two, calcarea fluor and calcarea foss plays a very vital role in treating the avian, because the problem lies over there. So calcarea fluor is the remedy for covering the degeneration as well as regeneration. It plays a very vital role in remodeling of that whatever remaining part of the head of the femur is there. And it again gets counter. And these are two remedies which are very essential in utilizing in such types of cases. Natrum salve, psychotic inflammatory condition, Kalifos, it's a very good remedy which covers the neuralgia, as well as it tranquilizes the patient. Patient is in agony, patient is in stress, is in a restless situation whenever he is having the avian. Kalifos is there, tranquilizes. So if you understand this pathophysiology, this is very superficial, this is the core which I have understood. But you have to understand it by depth, reading the Schussler. So we'll go ahead a little bit. There are 28 combinations. if you know the names, it's good. If you don't know name, very good, because I know never prescribe what are the name given to them. So these are the 28 combinations. It is worldwide WHO recommended combinations, and there are names given. One is anemia, two is asthma, colic, etc. We will not go towards the names. We will go towards something else. But you must know what each combination contains and how it acts. This is important. Instead of keeping names in your mind, you understand what is there in bicombination 26. You must know what is there in 23. What is there in 17. So, this is my personal 29 years experience that biochemic salts, when used on the basis of their physiological molecular actions, as mentioned by Schussler. In fact, he was the lazy person. That's why he has concentrated more on the 12 tissue salts, being an homeopath. And he said that this is more important. It acts at the pathological level very easily. So works very fast, hastens the cure process. These medicines act at the semi-dynamic level. This is important because they are not purely dynamic, because they are used in 6x, 3x, 12x. Until 24x, it is a semi-dynamic. Either little bit material, little bit dynamic. Biocombination 26, bi-dynamic is easy perturbation, but it contains following tissue salts which cover the patient's pathology perfectly. So there are four salts which are there in 26. Instead of giving separate out of them, you consider, even though name is easy perturbation, you think what is there. Main two remedies are there. Calcarea fluor is there, calcarea fos is there, both in 6x potency. See, degenerative pathology and vascular affections is more common with the calcarea fluor. Calcarea fluor covers the exostosis. It covers the osteophytes. It has the capacity to dissolve those osteophytes. So whenever there is a problem at the level of the surface and flattening happens, it is very important to remove those osteophytes, and because of which there is obstruction in movements, calcarea fluor plays a very vital role. Calcarea fos is also useful because there is already degeneration, and what requires is the regeneration over there. So for remaining part of the bone, it should be supplied with proper nutrient. Calcarea fos plays a role and it gives strength to the joint, so it never collapses. Because there is fear always in the patient's mind. Every orthopedician tells them it might collapse and there will be problem. Fear, patient comes to you in panic because they fear if it collapses, what will happen? Nothing happens. MacFos, yes, it is fosamentin. Galifos, I have already told, neuralgia. So, if you consider four remedies in one biocombination, how this is useful? I used to use in degenerative bony and musculopathies, such as osteoarthritis, the cervical and lumbar spondylosis, avian vascular necrosis. This is too important to be utilized. You use it and then find it out how it acts, how it works. And it works along with your constitutional remedy. And it produces very good results. Same is true. I have, there are only three combinations which contains calcarea fluor. One is 26, one is 23, and another is 17. 23 by name is toothache, but it contains three salts. Calcarea fluor, ferumfos, macfos. So first stage of inflammation, spasm, as well as degenerative pathology. So useful in any degenerative pathology, you, instead of toothache, you can use it at that. And this is third one, which is again, where calcarea fluor, along with calcarea galifos, but two important things, first and second stage of inflammation is covered because of ferumfos and calcarea. If there is a marrow edema, there is a lot of effusion inside the joint. Calimur plays a very vital role. If there is associated congestion, ferumfos is there. Calcarea fluor, yes, definitely degenerative pathology and vascular affections are covered. Califos is one more remedy which covers or tranquilizes that patient. So degenerative inflammatory frustrating condition, think of 17. This is my aspect. This is not given in any book. I used it, and my number of students who are there watching this video also, webinar also, they used to do their practice and they get the very good results with this. It's upon you. You try in your practice. If you satisfy, okay, continue. If you don't satisfy, leave this. But this is very important. Only 2-3 slides are important remaining. So little bit time. Location arises. Always arises, why not safety or legacy zone? This is definitely a debatable issue. My answer to the question is Zappian legacies alone can be sufficient, but it will take its own time to work, though you use it in any context. The group of patients generally I used to see is not that much of capable of understanding difference between palliation and pain. They want the difference in pain and early result. And this was not the issue for this case, but as a routine, I prescribed it to them. And why not we should be result oriented? Since 29 years, I'm working on these biochemic salts, and those being the semi-dynamic, found to produce very fast results at the cellular level. If the marrow edema settles immediately, patient becomes very comfortable to continue the treatment for long duration. Calcarea fluor is the medicine which has capacity to dissolve osteoblasts. I have experienced it number of times regarding this action. In cases of osteoarthritis, spondylosis, spinal canal stenosis, I have used and I have cured number of spinal canal stenosis cases with the help of this salt. And that's why, last slide which I want to highlight, as first case was very acute and recent in appearance, even though the disease is chronic in nature, proper homeopathic management can bring such patients very fast. Nowadays, I am treating avascular necrosis of them. What I observed is lactase, sepia, and calcarea fluor appeared commonly in those cases. So I studied the cases in retrospective manner, and to find out that whether I am becoming a little bit prejudiced, so I considered it again, but I found that action of vascular system, circulation, and venous system, it worked nicely. So we must study actions of our medicines at the cellular level, tissue level, so that we can make out our Materia Medica more rich and more perfect. So I have shared a lot. Thank you being there with me since long time. I know Dr. Gaurang, who has seen this, observed this, and given me a chance to share my views regarding the AVN. It's a little bit fast, I have to do that thing. But okay, I want to give something different thought, which is absolutely different I'm using, and that's what I feel so. So thank you everyone, thank you Shishir, Dr. Gaurang over there. So I'll hand over to the Dr. Gaurang.
It's a pleasure. We really had a very, very interesting time. The way you have analyzed the cases, and yes, I think it's important to respect everyone's approach, because there's so much to learn from everyone. I think your approach is quite interesting, and most important thing is the results, isn't it? The results is what is most important thing. Baki sab is also.
Yes, I have at present 301 case data, and it is analyzed completely, and more than 60% are having very good results. In fact, they are walking 4 to 5 kilometers a day, and they are doing all activities. And result, it is not just now. It is, I am working it on 2002 with those cases.
Fantastic. So tell us, Dr. Rasar, because sir, you are practicing since how many years now?
29.
Wow. 29.
Wow. 1991, I have started my practice.
Okay. So when you started off initially, which were the homeopaths you saw or you heard about, or you were inspired by anyone in that area? Because just a little bit about.
Basically, I will share with you my experience. It's very important. I was in fourth year of BHMS. I met Dr. Nitin Bagli, who was requiring a resident in his hospital. So I went to him, I talked to him. He said that, yes, your father is doctor. He was not confident about me, whether I will do all work or not. He said, you meet me after 2 days. And I went to him again. Yes, sir, I want to join. And the only thing is that I want to remain over there. I want a staying facility. And he has given me a room. And there was a case, in fact, of one of the worker over there. She was suffering from severe asthma. And she was not doing any work. She used to come and she sits like that, bending forward, keeping her hands like that. I asked, sir, she was not doing any work. How you can keeping her? He said, Prasad, since I have started hospital, she was with me. okay, she's not doing the work, but she was the founder member, so I cannot remove her. So ask directly to that lady, shall I give a homeopathic medicine to her? She said yes. So I read a lot of things regarding the asthma. I went into college library. I was in BS, Dr. Mosati. I went in college library.
Achha, Pune. You are actually from Pune. Pune.
Yeah, no, I am from Sangamnet, Pune. I have learned from Dr. Mosati.
Okay.
So I read everything, and then I start. I have discussed with my colleagues. That was first case I have to treat with homeopathy. There was fear in my mind. So we have come to three remedies. First is actually a Kalikab and Medorinum. And third remedy was arsenic. But everyone was knowing that arsenic is the remedy for asthma. So we have tried with arsenic 30. She felt better for 2 days. Recurrence was there. One day thereafter we shifted to Kalikab. Same thing happened. Medorinum was done also. Whether to give or not to give. There was a fear in the mind because it was taught to us that nozards can aggravate the condition. And in what potency? That was the thought again. Because little bit materialistic concepts were there. 200 is less powerful, 100 is more powerful. So there was fear in mind. So ultimately we decided we give Medorinum 200 to that lady. Asked Gangubai, you take this medicine and if I left the for college. I told her, if you have any problem, to Dr. Shinde, who was MD over there, and get admitted if you have any problem. And when I came in the evening for the hospital, in the hospital, she was absolutely normal. And till today, it was long, long history. She never had asthma there.
Beautiful, beautiful. I think such kind of cases inspire us a lot.
Yes, that was the first impact. I have started with the practice with my own. I have learned only from our college. I have learned a lot from Dr. Arya sir. Who were there, the practitioners who used to practice?
Dr. M.P. Arya.
Yeah, Dr. M.P. Arya, he was the principal at that time. So I used to attend OPDs over there continuously, but I have not gone to anyone for learning. luckily, in 1994, I have started practice in 1991, and till 1994, I was working only with Allen's Boric and 12 tissue remedies. In 1994, first time I have attended Dr. Rajan Shankaran sir's seminar in Mumbai, and that gave me absolutely different view, understanding the patient. That seminar was for the introduction of substance of homeopathy, which was written at that time. Earlier, I got both the books early, 8 days before. So I read both the books and I went to that seminar. And I enjoyed a lot. I learned a lot. And thereafter, every book written by him, I have read, understood. And I never left any seminar from sir thereafter. And I have got the themes. But only thing is that my way of practice is still the same. It is not different, or it is not with a specific approach. I'm practicing with my own way, the way I have started.
I think you should stick to your approach. You should stick to what is working for you, and not anywhere else. So I think what you're doing is original, and you should just focus there. Few questions. Which is your favorite materia medica? Which are the materia medicas you really think are interesting for you, and you read a lot? I know you will say Allen Boric, but it's interesting for you. What anything else that's interesting for you?
I used to read source books, basically. Allen Boric, yes, definitely. I used to use every time I used to teach my students those books. But I'm very happy with the Kent's Materia Medica. I'm very happy with the N.M. Chowdhury's Materia Medica or Margaret Tyler's Materia Medica. All the source books I used to read, and even the synoptic key from the Boger. All the things, even condensed
Materia Medica. Dr. Alpesh, my friend, is a master of synoptic key. Maybe sometime you should have a Jugalbandi session, Dr. Alpesh.
Yes. Definitely. All those books. And basically, one thing I want to share, but you want to develop your approach or understand the dynamics clearly. I have seen only first man who has a thorough understanding of dynamics is Dr. Rajan Shankaran. I advise to each and every student, you first read The Spirit, the Substance, and Soul of Remedies. and then go ahead with homeopathy, because you can understand the concepts very clearly.
I think those are the best books, absolutely.
Yes. Yes.
And how did you get in touch with Dr.? Tell us a little bit, how did you get in touch with Dr. Paranspet?
It was my one of the colleagues. He is also, in fact, he was, I think, batchmate of Paranspet, Dr. Sidram Kalashetty, who used to practice with in homeopathy at Pune. And I used to do a workshop sessions in my setup. I'm having a big auditorium of 100 students who can attend the seminars over there. That is Hahnemann Hall. And I used to conduct homeopathic workshop, live cases, and with the help of cases I used to teach. That was different approach in homeopathy. So I used to conduct twice in a year earlier. So
wow.
Dr. Sidram Kalashetty, who joined me in second workshop, and he came and he joined and he remained with me. And thereafter we have continued for 2-3 years workshop. Thereafter every second Sunday seminar, that is our specialty. And myself and Dr. Kalashetty used to conduct those seminars. And then he introduced me. There was a seminar conducted by Dr. Kalashetty and Paranspet sir at the their college in Chinsworth. And we got a very good friend thereafter. And we become 4 members now to conduct second Sunday seminar. So Dr. Kalashetty, Dr. Shishir Paranspet, and one of my students who practices in Sangam, Dr. Ajit Kasar, he is practicing since last 6-7 years, and he is there. So we used to conduct, 4 of us used to conduct every month second Sunday, and we become very good friends. We used to discuss lot of things.
Okay. Beautiful, beautiful. So tell us, in your life with homeopathy and so many things, you know, you're so experienced, how did you get that passion to reach to this level? You know, you have auditorium, you have a big center, you have treated thousands of cases. What does it take to be this person that you are? How did you become Dr. Rasa?
Basically, one thing was that I have entered in the college to become a doctor, because I had my father in a 20-bedded hospital. It was only first 5 hospitals in Sangam. But because of Dr. Bhagli sir, he every time introduced me with number of patients, introduced the way he introduced, he was very good orator. He used to talk with these two, their patients very nicely. And what he does, he said every time to the patients, if he is an orthopedician, if any other patient asks, sir, I am having problem with the stomach, so please give me medicine. He used to tell his Dr. Rasar, he is there in our hospital in the afternoon, you go to him. He is the topper in Pune University, he is first student of Pune University in 1990. I am taking his medicine, you take medicine, homeopathic medicine from him, and you will get very good result. And he has given me a number of patients at that time. So that was in fact the very important thing. And thereafter I have converted to homeopathy. I came to Sangam, asked my father that I want to go with homeopathy. He was in confusion whether he would really continue with homeopathy or not, because there was I have to do both practices, homeopathy as well as his practice. I have to follow first for it. I told him in 1995, I don't want to do any allopathic practice. You continue with your allopathy. I want to do a separate practice, and I changed my practice from that place into a different area in Sangam. I started with homeopathy. Right from first day, I was a teacher. And because there is a college in Sangam, Homeopathic Medical College. And luckily, on the first day only, I met the chairman of the college on his bus stand, and he asked me, Dr. Sahib, Dhala ka tumto complete. And he said, yes, you do come our college as a teacher. So I went over there. I was happy that whether you will ask me to take organ and materia medica and that effort. And what happened? He asked me to teach pathology, because there is no pathology teacher. And what one more incident he has said,
Up till now, four people have tried, and this student, this is the first batch of our college. All of lot of students have done BSc, and they are, in fact, they are of more than your age. So, okay, I will teach the pathology. I started first lecture. I have worked hard with inflammation, and I have explained in the simple manner the way I have understood the inflammation. I started with that. In that first lecture, all students gathered around me. They told me, sir, first time after 6 months we have understood what is inflammation. And that was the first incidence with which I got the confidences I can speak. That was the first incidence I got the confidence. Yes, I can speak.
No, I think you're a good speaker. There is no doubt about it. And main thing is your clinical knowledge is the most important thing.
So that is because of Dr. Nitin Bagli. He asked me to go with. He has given me gifts: clinical Hutchinson, clinical Esdas, and he has given it to me. Yes, Prasad, this is for you, and you have to read.
I think our mentors have played a very important role in life, isn't it?
Yes, definitely.
Dr. Gaurang, I want to add something.
Please add, sir.
Yes, he's a very good clinician, he's a good teacher. And very important, he is a voracious reader. What we can complete in 10 to 15 days, he completes in 2 days.
My God.
He's a voracious reader.
Sir, how do you do it? What is the secret of voracious reading? Tell us. Aap bata do aaj.
Basically, it is there right from, their roots are there right from my father and mother. Both of them are good readers. And I used to read because of them and our whole family, not only me, my son, my daughter, my wife, everyone is a reader. We used to fight on reading only because I used to read everything, not only with homeopathy. I have more than 4,500 book collection with
me.
Wow.
I think this is the secret of being successful. Reading a lot of books and not watching a lot of Netflix and Amazon, which all of you guys are doing right now. बंद करो और एक खुद पे घर पे बिगिन अ लाइब्रेरी ऑफ योर ओन और जस्ट वॉच मटेरिया मेडिका सीरीज बाय अस दैट्स द ओनली अल्टरनेटिव
वन थिंग आई वांट टू ऐड गौरव देयर इज अ मटेरिया मेडिका वाइवा बुक बाय जॉर्ज विटलकस दैट इज आल्सो वन ऑफ द बुक आई एम गेटिंग फैसिनेटेड एंड वन मोर डॉक्टर रॉबिन मर्फीज कीनोट्स मोस्ट प्रैक्टिकल मोस्ट क्लिनिकल इन माय लाइफ
I don't know. I had sent my books to you through Dr. Parans, but I don't know if you got it.
Yes, I got. It is there with me. Decoding the Mental Rosaries. This is there.
My
God. Already
how was it for
from
you?
It's good.
How was it for you?
It's good.
What was the interesting thing for you? I would like to know from you. What was the interesting thing for you?
Basically, I have lot of rubrics from your book. That is very important. I like book which explains the logic, and that's why I love the Dr. Shankaran's book. In the similar manner, your book also explains the logic why you have selected that remedy. If anyone is able to tell why he has selected the remedy, I'm happy, because whether it works or it doesn't work, it doesn't matter. Basically, he should have a reasoning. That is my concept. The logic should be there behind that. Because number of times when I was a student, I asked my teacher, sir, why you have prescribed this remedy? And they used to tell, read in the books. I don't like this. Read in the books, that we know, but how we can apply it.
Many people who don't know or don't want to say or don't want to inspire say that actually. But anyways, very, very quick thing, Dr. Parans Pe, there is one doctor in the group chat who has written, please name the books written by Dr. Parans Pe. Aapne bataya nahi?
I am following Dr. Gaurang and he will guide me shortly and I'll write something.
We are waiting. They are saying Dr. Paranjpe ke books kidhar hai. But anyway, if you want to ever buy any books, you have to contact Dr. Pratik because he has Homeopathic Hub where he has collection of all the books. But coming back, Dr. Rasan, I want to collaborate with you and we will work together and we'll do something very interesting together. There are some things in my mind. Ab saath mein achha kaam karenge.
101%. Only one thing, Dr. Gaurang, I want to share. I give admission to my clinic. You know, there is a clinical group. Every day we used to discuss for 1.5 hours in the evening, 5:30 to 7. And only thing I used to tell, there is no fee structure, nothing else. You have to pay 3,500 and you have to purchase the books for 3,500. That is compulsory for every student.
It's a good idea.
All four books.
I'm thinking of joining that actually.
So that our students will get a lot of knowledge if you come over here.
I will genuinely we'll make a plan and I'll come and learn from you for 2 days. Sit with you next to you and observe how you're doing. I always go to many homeopaths. I sit and I learn. Bahut acha lagta.
It's my pleasure, definitely.
Absolutely.
But I want to say that I'm giving 4 books of Rajan Shankaran, Spirit, Substance, Soul, and Minerals from Shelton. These 4 books I used to give along with that in that 3,500.
Now you add my books. You do
yes,
one thing
I
now. You add my books.
I have already told Dr. Shishir that please tell me regarding that, and he said that
I
Dr.
Pratik
will call you.
I'm just joking, chill.
No. It was there. Doctor, he said that Dr. Pratik will call you regarding those, but still I was waiting and I
Dr. Pratik does a lot of people. He says that he will call and he doesn't call, and a lot of people have their complaints on Insta that he promises and he doesn't. Anyways, we'll not go there today. But anyways, coming back to it, sir, it was absolute pleasure, Dr. Rasa, Dr. Paranspe, to have you here. And I want to ask finally, how does it feel to come to this Materia Medica series, and what do you think about this series that we are doing?
Most important thing, I like your way of presenting the Materia Medica. You go to the core, you explain the way you have presented centuries today. Yes, I have utilized only 2 or 3 times in 29 years centuries. But the way you have presented every aspect, the psychological aspect, which was not written in detail with the Boric's Materia Medica, but with the reportorial approach, the way you have explained it, it's really too good. Yesterday, day before yesterday, Dr. Subhash Singh was there. Yes, he also has mentioned number of things. But it was not possible for me to attend all those sessions because I used to practice in between period.
I watch your videos in between, by the way. Whenever I get a chance in the afternoon, I see.
Yeah, at 2:30 to 4, I'm taking lectures regularly on PIM. And nowadays, Organon series is going on. I'm a impact professor in the Organon. And first aphorism, 4 days back, I have started until today, we are on first aphorism.
Dr. Paranspe, question to you. How does it feel coming to Materia Medica series and sharing your cases? Because a lot of people are very inspired by your talk, actually.
Okay, first of all, I want to thank you first and Team Gaurang, Dr. Pratik Jain, Dr. Alpesh Oza, and the team. You are the Krishna of all this Pandava team, or I can say you are the A.R. Rahman of homeopathy. And I am really thankful to the viewers that...
ये क्वारंटाइन में महाभारता दिखा रहे हैं उसके लिए आप एग्जांपल दे रहे हैं इसका और इज इट नॉर्मली यू लाइक इट
आई एम टेलिंग द ट्रुथ यू आर द कृष्णा ऑफ होल होम्योपैथिक फैमिली सो इट वाज अमेजिंग एक्चुअली इट वाज अमेजिंग एक्सपीरियंस फ्रॉम माय साइड एंड आई एम रियली थैंकफुल टू द टीम एंड डेफिनेटली थिंग्स आर गोइंग वेरी लॉन्ग
अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल गॉट अ चांस टू हियर बोथ ऑफ यू सो वी आर वेरी हैप्पी फाइनली वोट ऑफ थैंक्स बाय डॉक्टर अल्पेश एंड डॉक्टर प्रतीक बिकॉज दे आर द मेन पिलर्स ऑफ आवर whole Materia Medica series. Dr. Pratik, he always has breakfast, lunch and dinner while the sessions are on. That's why he may not answer a lot of your things. And Dr. Alpesh does the whole thing sitting in the clinic. So he's actually seeing patients and doing all these things. So it's really crazy. So please say something, vote of thanks, sir.
I think before we end the session, I think we'll, from Monday onwards, we'll be having MM series at 3 p.m. in the afternoon.
Okay.
So,
all right. Okay. Dr. Alpesh, you are saying something.
And there is a participant who has told that you have made us fall in love with homeopathy again. So, that's
what?
A wonderful, I would say, wonderful feedback.
Super. Okay, so I think love is a good word to end our talk to. I think Dr. Rasa wants to say something. Say, sir.
One thing, Dr. Gaurang. It's because of you and your a lot of people who are in fact stimulated because of you towards the homeopathy. That's my experience, because every student used to tell me, yeah, you are on Gaurang's platform. Yes, very good. N number of students. Your reference, reference is there right from the Dr. Suraj Thorat, it is there from Dr. Prachi Ambedkar. They used to my students, and everyone is very much happy. And the way you teach, the way you help, the way you have a lot of team working along with you, and you give a lot of importance to all of your students. It's really very good, and continue with that. And whatever help if you require anytime, I will be there with your group. Definitely, I will suggest.
Your blessings are very important for us. Always. Your blessings are always important for us. So on that note, I want to also quickly tell you the reason also, because we invited Dr. Paranspe and Dr. Rasa. There was one of our participants, Dr. Prachi Ambedkar, who actually, please recorrect me the spelling and all that. I think Dr. Prachi wrote to us that she wanted us to invite Dr. Rasa and Dr. Paranspe. So if you want us to invite someone particularly, you tell us and we will get that person in flesh and blood in front of you and do the Materia Medica series. So with this note, I think Dr. Pratik, Dr. Alpesh, you can just call it a day. Some vote of thanks, final
think,
vote of thanks.
Getting suggestions from people would be the best thing. I mean, that would take us more further to people whom we don't even know or who are not even, you know, social or active or whatever.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Super. Then let's call it a day. Thank you so much, Dr. Pratik, Dr. Alpesh, for arranging this. And Dr. Rasa and Dr. Paranspe, it was an amazing session, both of you.
Amazing.
We had a really good
day. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
See you all on Monday 3 p.m. Facebook Live.
Monday 3 p.m. But don't forget to connect tomorrow at 6 o'clock for the greatest webinar ever in the entire quarantine history. See me tomorrow at 6 with Dr. Sankaran. Okay? All right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.